the single group that has the highest fatality rate are people who have been on ventilators for a long period of time. The hospital is saving most of those patients, but we are probably going to see these kinds of numbers a little bit longer. As always, the loss of life is personal to us. Detroit is a big, small town, and yesterday we lost another city employee, Courtney Jackson, who was a supervisor, boiling inspector, been a city employee for 24 years, and was one of the most popular people in the department. Mr. Jackson was a father of three, was somebody you could count on all the time, and was well known among his coworkers at the annual picnic and showing off his chess prowess, where he would take on all comers. But our hearts go out to Mr. Jackson and his family. And he was the eighth city employee, and probably will have a confirmation on a ninth tomorrow. But this has been very personal to us. While the number of deaths is higher today, all the data we're seeing from the hospitals continues to go a positive direction. The number of patients in the hospital are down, the number of patients on ventilators are down significantly, and what I will continue to say is the ultimate report card to the people of the city of Detroit, the TCF Field Hospital, after 6 days of operation, has 16 patients. And I have said from the beginning, if this city is disciplined about social distancing, we won't need 1,000 beds there. We can hold it down to 200 or 250 beds. And it looks now like it's possible. We'll do even better as long as we keep on doing what we're doing. And you know, it's so interesting. People will post online about a police call because a group of people are gathered, as if there's something wrong with that. In fact, it's just the opposite. Every time a group of people starts to gather in this town, neighbors call the police, the police come out, and it dissipates almost immediately. And when I see those social media posts about a police report of a group of people, it means that the neighbors in this community are watching out for each other and breaking up those gatherings. And as I say, 99% of the time, the people in this city have been absolutely terrific in watching out for each other. We are dramatically ramping up our nursing home testing, and the numbers continue to be disturbing. We've gotten 420 instant nursing home tests done. 35% of everybody we've tested has been positive. We have a crisis in the nursing homes. I know it's true around the country, and we're going to test another 2,000 folks over the next week or so. And Denise Fair and her team have now got a rapid response team that once the tests are complete and the nursing homes are given lists of who is positive and who is negative, we are going to be absolutely certain that the patients are properly separated, and that those who need the care get the care, and those who aren't infected are separated from those who are. But it continues to be a source of real concern, and I'm going to start dealing with some of these nursing home directors myself if we don't see a significant commitment in keeping these patients well. 10 days ago, the nursing homes didn't really have a tool because it took 5-6 days to get test results back. Now they've got the tool. We'll come in and swab, we'll give you the test the next morning. There is no excuse for the nursing homes not to respond to this issue directly. And finally, I just want to say to the city employees, the reaction today, I mean, it wasn't an easy day, but the reaction across the city has been so professional. And people are, I think, really understanding now as they look at this, and our department has been meeting with employees and will be for the next couple days. And the thing that I think our full-time employees realize is every single full-time employee is keeping their health care. And in this time, that was critical. And the other thing I think our employees understand is we want you back. This isn't that we're laying you off so that you're gone. We are reducing your hours because you're important to us, and we want you back. And so on Saturday, the city HR department is going to file the unemployment or underemployment benefits for everybody. None of our employees are going to have to file a form. And so you've seen all the stories about the system being overloaded, but the governor and her team have been great in cooperating with us. And so we will file all of this ourselves. And there's been a lot of talk about what the federal government has done well and done badly. And it seems like we pay a lot of attention to what the federal government has done badly. This CARES bill is an example of what the federal government did really well, the president, Republicans, and Democrats in Congress. Because what they have done, and our employees are starting to understand this now, is with the supplemental $600 a week through July 31st, they have made it possible for employers who can't afford to pay their employees to put them on furlough or to lay them off and not lose them. And I saw one of the newspapers here did a critical editorial saying it discourages people from looking for work because you're paying them the extra $600 a week. To which I say, exactly. It was what they intended to do. Congress got this right. Imagine that you've got a finance department where people have expertise in your company. If they got laid off and went somewhere else, if you go to restart the economy in 3 months, you've lost them. You've got people who do the building inspections in this town. If they get laid off and go someplace else, in 90 days we want to start building again, we don't have experienced inspectors because they took another job. Imagine across the economy what would happen if people all switched jobs over a pandemic that I believe will be under control in a few months. And so what the President and Congress did was very well thought out in providing that supplement of $600 a week. And I think our employees now, as they're doing their calculations, are realizing that for the most part, financially, it's going to come out pretty close. The fact that we cut the hours and kept the health care means nobody has to worry about losing their health care in the middle of a pandemic. And I think our employees are really understanding that this was done in a way that was because we valued them, we want them back, we believe this is temporary. And starting next week, we're going to start to plan on who comes back and in what order. I was really impressed that Eric Jones, our fire commissioner, needs EMTs who have to go through a training academy. Most of it can be done online. And so he's now designing an online training academy so that he can get his EMTs certified so that we're ready to rehire. They'll come right in. We're starting to think about how to safely ramp our workforce back up job by job. And we're going to start to lay those plans out. But Dave Masseron, our CFO, who's here, will answer any questions. He and the team did a really great job of figuring out how to deal with a potentially terrible deficit in a responsible way and in a way that leaves us in a position that if, in fact, this economy does reopen in the next few months, our employees can afford to wait for us to reopen and come back to their old jobs where they're wanted. And with that, I'll turn it over to our health director, Denise Fair.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to begin by thanking all of those who are continuing to keep our city safe and running. I can't say this enough, so thank you. Today's confirmed COVID-19 count among the residents includes 7,141 cases and 469 deaths. My heart continues to grieve for these families because every number represents one of our neighbors. Mother, father, brother, sister, child, these are our Detroiters who have left us. Our data now shows that we are seeing fewer new cases. However, I still urge caution. There are still so many things we are continuing to learn about this virus. So we must continue to wash our hands, disinfect surfaces, cover our coughs, wear a mask, and distance ourselves. And most importantly, remain home per the governor's executive order, which is still in place. Now, we've received a lot of questions about our data, and that data is available on our website. It highlights COVID-19 cases by race, gender, and age group. We've also included a heat map, which demonstrates the area of high density of cases where it's appearing all across the city of Detroit. Now, this data remains fluid, and we know that this virus is widespread across the city. I encourage residents to visit our website at detroitmi.gov/coronavirus for this and other COVID-related information, because knowledge is power. We also know that vulnerable populations like our homeless and those seniors are more adversely impacted by COVID-19, and we are being aggressive. Last Monday, I mentioned that the Detroit Health Department would be increasing our focus on seniors across all the nursing homes in Detroit. And we have partnered with the Detroit Fire and EMT, Henry Ford, the medical students from Wayne State, because our goal is to test seniors and staff in all 26 nursing locations within just a matter of a few days, about a week and a half. And I am pleased to share that we are on track. We will also continue monitoring and supporting testing for our homeless population, where currently a relatively small number of these cases, less than 30, are under quarantine at the city's shelter. Now, I remain invigorated by Detroiters, our city, and our partners in addressing COVID-19 head on. The health department is committed to working in partnership with all of those who want to ensure Detroiters are safe and healthy throughout this pandemic and beyond. So let's continue to fight the fight by staying home, protecting ourselves, because this is our responsibility. We want to make sure that we come back from this as a community even more strong. So please do stay safe, and please stay home. And with that, I'll turn it back over to the mayor.
All right, and Dave Masseron, our CFO, his team basically put in 18, 20-hour days to put this financial proposal together. When I first saw the size of the revenue shortfall, I thought it was going to be, the impact was going to be far more severe on our employees. But they deserve credit. And Dave, I don't know if you want to say anything about the team and what they did in putting this plan together.
Well, thank you, Mayor. I would take a moment to recognize not only the team, Tanya Stottemeyer, our budget director, Katie Hammer, my chief deputy, and a number of staff and all of our agency CFOs, but each of the department directors had to work countless hours with us. Every single position in the city needed to be analyzed to determine what category that the mayor laid out last night an employee or group of employees fit in. So you have employees like Ms. Fair, like Brad Dick, that are working 24 hours a day to make sure that our residents are served in this time of crisis, but they're also spending time to work with our staff to ensure that we have a fiscally sustainable path going forward. So it was truly a team effort. The work that my team did throughout the CFO organization has been nothing short of heroic. The mayor has repeatedly praised Boise Jackson for the work he's done on procurement. But, you know, one of the things that has gone completely without drama is our payroll team has made payroll for every city employee for this entire crisis. We had planned for alternative work sites, but we had never planned for our workforce to be completely working remote. And we've been able to, that team has been able to, through Regina Greer's leadership, to make sure that our police, our EMS, our fire, and all of our city employees have continued to get paid. So I can't say enough about the effort of the management team and all of our city employees.
All right, with that, we'll take any questions.
Hello, everyone. Eli Newman, WDET Public Radio. Question for Mr. Masseron. So concerning the 2024 pension cliff, as the city draws upon its rainy day funds, where does it leave pensioners?
So an important part of this plan, one of the most important parts of this plan, is our long-term ability to meet those obligations. In this fiscal year 21 budget, or next year's budget, we plan to continue to make deposits as scheduled into the Retiree Protection Fund, and at this point see no reason that we won't be able to make that payment in 2024 and beyond.
Sure, and I guess more broadly, so in terms of these the layoffs and the hour cuts and the pay cuts, how much of it is currently happening, and what requires like city council approval?
It's all happening, so it'll all be effective on Monday. So those things are being done. Everything I laid out last night is being done by executive order. It's happening now. And the starting July 1st, the new fiscal year, that will be dependent upon City Council's action. I have to say the reaction we've had from City Council members has been extremely positive, and I think they were surprised that we were able to handle this where all full-time employees kept their health care. I think that was something that was a big positive. But ultimately, City Council will adopt a budget going forward on July 1st.
Sure. And concerning the Financial Review Commission, I mean, was there any wiggle room or communication with the governor or with Lansing in terms of possibly having this year be a buy just because of the crisis?
There's no buy language in the state statute, but Dave can talk about the communication we did have.
Yeah, so we worked very closely with the state treasurer, the state treasurer's revenue team, to ensure that our estimates are reasonable. We went through the savings plan, and they believe that it's on first glance, they're going to have to review it over the next year, and they're going to have to watch how revenues come in, but they believe it's a credible plan for us to be balanced over the next 16 months.
They were very supportive of what they saw.
Sure. And lastly, I think you had mentioned that blight removal will be delayed in the year ahead, but does that mean that the establishment of a demolition department, has that also been delayed?
It's a problem that Council and I are going to have to address together, and I hope we find a solution in the next couple of weeks. Otherwise, there'll be no demolitions in this city for at least a year, and that would be a really bad outcome. So I hope we find a solution to that, and I guess I would say stay tuned.
Sure, and would that solution also include the blight bond proposal?
Yeah, and this is something that Council and I are going to have to agree on. So I failed to put together a package last year that they could support, but I'm hoping that with the changes we've made, we'll find something that we could support together. I don't think anybody wants to see us go a year and have the blight start to retake this neighborhood, so I'm hoping we're going to come up with a solution together.
Okay, thank you.
We have a number of questions from various outlets, and a couple of them have to do with contracting with the city. And one question is, what do we think the impact is going to be on companies that contract for the city, that do work for the city?
Those who have a contract will get paid on those contracts, and in the future, if we don't need the contracts, we won't contract in the future. But there's no impact on payments. It's not a cash problem. What I laid out last night, the $348 million revenue shortfall, is what's going to occur over the next 16 months. The city's in a good cash position, so we're not talking about slowing down payments to vendors or anything like that. But it's the kind of thing that if you act in April, you potentially can get through this without laying off full-time employees. If we acted in June, we would have to be laying off a lot of people. And so what we decided to do was act early, so that we can preserve health care for all of our full-time employees, but it's not going to impact vendor payments.
Okay, and secondarily, has the city considered negotiating or renegotiating with vendors to reduce costs?
So the purchasing director, Boise Jackson, is in the process of reaching out to all of our major long-term vendors. Obviously, if employees are taking some level of financial hit, we're going to try to make sure that our vendors contribute to that. So we'll be renegotiating all contracts. But as the mayor said, we'll continue to honor any contract we have. But long-term contracts, we're going to look to those vendors for savings.
Okay. And Mayor, I don't know if you mentioned this last night, but are you recommending that the other city agencies like the Land Bank and Water Department implement similar actions?
So everybody has to make a decision for themselves. If you have employees that you want to keep, I think the approach we took is the right one. Preserve the health care and rely on the CARES Act to keep your employees largely whole until July 31st. If you have employees that you're not going to need long term, you make different decisions. And so I know Mr. Mazaron's talking to each of those agencies, and we're hearing from governments all over after the announcement last night of the way we approached it, how we kept health care for all employees. I think you're going to see other municipalities in the state follow our lead.
Okay. A few questions on supply chain. ML Alaric from the Detroit Free Press wants to know if we ever, if the state ever received that shipment of 200,000 swabs.
No.
Okay. And
I have to tell him I'm glad we had the one for him, though. I hope he's recovering well.
Yeah, he's doing well.
I saw that his wife is doing well.
Yeah, I think he's back to work today.
Okay.
He also wants to know, what supplies has the city received from the feds?
I don't know that we've received any directly. They've done some allocations to the state that we've gotten some pieces of. But by and large, Boise Jackson, our procurement director, has gotten the supplies on our own. What the federal government has been doing, what the state's been doing, is they've been giving priority to the hospitals, which you can understand. And from our standpoint, doing things like our own testing sites, masks to our own employees and the like, most of that stuff we've done ourselves.
Okay. Question from Christine Ferretti at the Detroit News regarding the uptick in deaths. And I don't know if you addressed this earlier or not, but she wanted to know whether it's an actual trend or if it's just delayed reporting on some previous ones.
I'm obsessive about data by now, everybody knows. If you looked at, we reported, I think, 18 and 19 deaths on Saturday and Sunday, and then higher deaths the last 2 days. And this whole reporting system in this state is just not reliable. And so Saturdays and Sundays, stuff doesn't get reported. It tends to come in later. And so a part of it is that. Part of it is that we are seeing folks, as I mentioned before, who have been on ventilators for 2 or 3 weeks who are having bad outcomes. And so the two of those things together is causing the uptick you've seen in deaths the last couple days. When I look at how many patients are on the ventilators in the hospitals in Detroit, they're down significantly. When I see what the usage is over the TCF Center, it's lower than anybody would have projected. If we keep our social distancing, we're going to be out of this sooner rather than later. We're now on a rate where the deaths are doubling every 10 or 12 days. If we keep doing what we're doing, that's going to drop significantly further pretty quickly.
Okay. One clarification from Cranes on the demolition program. Would there be no demolitions, or would there be some limited demolitions for emergencies?
If there were a situation of safety, you know, a house was on the verge of falling over in a neighborhood with kids, we'll go in and take care of that imminent danger. But if we don't find a source of funding, that's all that will be done for the next year.
Okay. And lastly, a couple of forward-looking questions from John Hewitt at WWJ. Wants to know how you gauge the risk of people going back to work, Detroit and nationally, against the risk of a second wave of COVID.
So it's exactly the question, and we put together a team today that's starting to look at that. And I just, you know, I just believe in being honest with it. We're going to say our street sweepers in China, they've been sweeping the street. Our street sweepers who are by themselves in a cab, there should be a protocol that says the machines are clean, the drivers have masks. We test to make sure that everybody is negative. That kind of a worker can come back sooner maybe than some of our offices where we have a large group of people clustered into one area. And so what I have asked the department heads to start doing is we're going to think through site by site, and I'm going to keep saying this. I go to work on the 11th floor of the mayor's office every single day, as does John. And we are very strict in our protocols. I feel completely safe in the way we're doing it. We're not bringing anybody back to work that we don't have those same medical protocols. And so Dr. Rob Dunn is helping us design them. And I can't tell you if it's going to be May, June, or July. But we are going to look at job by job and bring folks back when we're confident we can do it safely.
Related to that, a second part of that question is there feeling that we would have enough testing kits to be able to test everybody who needs to be tested to reactivate?
So we'll do it with the Abbott 15-minute tests. Right now they're producing 50,000 test kits a day for the country, and we've been getting 1,200 every 4 or 5 days, which has been just fine for us. It's about the amount that we could handle. I know Abbott plans to dramatically increase that. I'm on very good terms with their CEO, and when their capacity increases, we'll increase. But you could imagine having a unit, say, of 20 or 25 folks who we wanted to bring back early because they were critical. We could test those 20 or 25 people, let everybody know if you're positive or negative. We can have thermometers, as we do now at the police and the fire department and at DDOT every single day. If you look at what we have done at the Detroit Police Department, where we were 2 weeks ago, where we were having 100 people being quarantined a day, and now where it's basically 3 or 4 a day, we had to learn how to do this, and Dr. Dunn really wrote the protocols. We're having the same success at DDOT now as far as minimal number of new quarantines every day. We will bring people back when we know we can do it safely, and I'm not predicting a time on that, but we're starting to plan for it.
Okay, and one last question from ML again. He said that in New York they have reclassified some deaths of individuals who had not tested positive as corona-related deaths, and is wondering if we're considering the same thing. I don't know if you're...
Again, I haven't seen the data. I have no doubt that it's true everywhere in the country, that, you know, we have 30,000 people die every year of flu. I mean, in this country, year in and year out. And so it's possible that people have died where nobody ran a test. And we're looking at that, but I think probably in every city in the country, some number of people have died who were never tested and haven't been evaluated. We haven't dug into that data. Right now, I'm really focused on the people who are alive and keeping them alive. At some point, we may go back and try to deal with that, but I'm very confident that we know today how many people we have in the hospital, how many positives we have, how they're all being handled.
Okay, it's the last question.
Okay, anybody else? Thank you very much.
And let me extend a consideration as well. The announcement we made yesterday around our phased strategy based upon science, based upon health data, also assumes that if people go back into the community and begin to have contact where they're not putting on face coverings, where they're not always practicing the kind of physical distancing that they currently are with the stay-at-home order, that we could see an increase in the number of people infected. We have to provide the capacity in the system and make sure we procure that capacity before we enter into that next phase. So every one of those beds, from my perspective, are important in terms of our capacity to deliver on the hope and promise that we can start to ease up on the home orders. And so I don't think it's an overcorrection. I think it's an appropriate adaptation to the current new normal and provide us the kind of relief valves if indeed we need them without having to be in a crisis mode but having already planned in that respect.